So I'm going to be talking about failure to disclose government interest in patents. This is work that, as Damien mentioned, we've been doing at Knowledge Ecology International. So the Bylaw Act requires contractors, that is normally universities and companies that get money from the US government, to disclose the fact that they receive government money in their patents. So think that what is normally called the government interest statements in patents. And these disclosures are an important policy tool because they inform the public about the role of the US government in the research and development that led to a particular invention or a set of inventions. And they provide federal agencies and the public in general with a better understanding of the rights that they might have around this publicly funded patents. And so things like marching rights, which is something that KEI has been heavily involved with, or free royalty-free uses, we know that a particular patent is subject to those provisions if there is a government interest statement. At least that's the easiest way to know. Contractors often fail to disclose this government interest statement in their patent. There has been research about this in the US by the GAO office, a report from the late 90s, and then a follow-up report in 2003, work around this issue of failure to disclose. And Professor Sampat, along with Artie Ray, who is here with us in the panel, has been has made critical empirical contributions to this field too. Obviously, I'm not going to mention his research. I suspect that he might address his findings here too. KEI and among advocacy groups have done all of the work, or most of the work, I think, in the U.S. and for what it's worth, globally, around failure to disclose. Since a few years ago, we have done several requests around several technologies that we think fail to disclose this government interest statement. I will make another point, which is that it's a problem not only to never disclose government interest in patents, but it's also a problem to do this very late and throughout certificate of corrections. And the reason why there's two main reasons why this is a problem. Number one, it's very hard to find these patents with government interest statement in certificate of corrections, basically because the USPTO do not have a search keyword for patent that disclosed throughout certificate of corrections. So it's very hard to find them. This is something that arguably the USPTO can fix, but they haven't done it yet. And the other problem is that this certificate of corrections tend to happen very late, several years after the patent has been initially filed. And so what you're seeing currently in the slide is a work data that I've been working on recently, which shows that indeed certificate of correction discloses government interest tend to happen on average about 9 years after the patent application was initially filed. So if we agree that the purpose of having this government interest statement is to have a better understanding of the rights and the role of the US government, and that we never know, or we know very late about this role, then probably the public interest is not being served appropriately when these disclosures are made through certificate of correction. I will come back to this issue of certificate of corrections at the end of my presentation. And so how at KEI, how do we do this research when we are trying to figure out whether there was a failure to disclose government interest in patents? So we start typically by identifying patents that lack government interest statement, either in the text of the patent or the certificate of corrections, which is what I just mentioned. And then we try to build as much data as we can about these patents to try to put them in a context, if you will, And typically we do that by getting the priority dates, the name of the inventors, information about the technology, so the claims, the abstracts, the title, and anything else that would allow us to better understand what is being what was patented in this occasion. And then we go out and look for the academic literature papers that are related to the technology that was patented. We also look into the NIH reporter, and in cases when the company is publicly traded, we look into the SEC forms, and quite frankly, everything that we can find around, that will give us information about the role of the US government around a particular technology, so that we can better, we can then compare the two, the patents and the evidence of government support. And if we see a correlation, then we think we are we have a failure to disclose here. And so we sometimes proceed with reports and requests to the federal agency to correct and to to adopt remedies around this failure to disclose. So in the case of Moderna, in the COVID-19 context, we started by looking into all of the patents that this company has obtained from the beginning of times until August of this year. And we found 126 patents assigned to this company. Not a single one of this patent, not even one, discloses government interest, which is quite remarkable, because if you've seen the news, you probably know that this company in the US, this company has received quite a lot of funding from the US government. I think other co-panelists here, Catherine and Sane, are gonna be talking about BARDA and the NIH. I will be talking about DARPA, which is another federal agency that has also funded Moderna, and I think it's the one that started earliest in their partnership with Moderna. So if you Google, if you search for Moderna in the DARPA website, one of the first things that you will find is this, picture, which very clearly explains that, they think that they have a role, they play a role in the development of their mRNA technology platform, which is what Moderna is using for the COVID-19 vaccine. So very clearly a role there. If we go to the SEC forms relating to Moderna, then we can get more information about things like the number of the contracts that they have with DARPA, when this contract started, which is very important to understand, what patent might be involved, and things like the amount of money that was allocated or directed to Moderna, and also information about the field of the technology, in this case, the mRNA technology platform, which is what they have been using in the COVID-19 candidate. If we look at the literature, the academic literature, we find at least two papers that was co-authored by Moderna scientists. And so we now know, and this paper discloses government funding from DARPA, and they relate to the chikungunya vaccine and the Zika virus vaccine, but both of them uses the mRNA technology platform. So now what we have is information, by looking at these sources, we know that Moderna indeed has been funded by DARPA. We know when this relation started, more or less, and we know which inventors actually worked on the DARPA funding. So now we can go back and look at the Moderna's patent portfolio and identify which patents are related, potentially related to the DARPA funding. And what we found was that at least 21 patents indeed name such inventors that receive funding or acknowledge funding in papers. And this patent were filed after the contracts with DARPA started. So we think that there's a failure to disclose in those cases. And that's what we requested DARPA to investigate. We've released a report and made a request to DARPA in late August 2020. On the very same day, it was covered by the Washington Post and then by the Financial Times. The Financial Times also has a pretty important quote from DARPA confirming that as a reaction, you know, immediately reacting to our request and launching an investigation around the Moderna patents, which was very important and quick. And other news sources also cover the story. These are a few of them. Senator Van Hollen, who is one of the co-sponsors of the We Pay Act, also tweeted about the research and the requests. This is cool because he proposes in the We Pay Act to adopt provisions around failure to disclose. I can talk about them later if people are interested. And 3 weeks after our report, DARPA directly confirmed to KEI that indeed they were investigating the patents that we think failed to disclose government interests. The next day after DARPA, you know, when the stock market opened, it seems that DARPA lost some stock value. At least this is what experts in the stock market believe. I wouldn't know that much. People believe it's because of a report that we published and the potential that DARPA could take title or at least has a stake in the patents. So I'll conclude with the remedies and saying this: if funding agencies never take title of patent that fail to disclose government funding, regardless of the facts, doesn't matter what happened, then they will be sending a signal to the companies, which is you can do better little to disclose government funding, because the worst that can happen is that you're going to have a bad PR day, and then maybe lose some value in your stocks, which you could probably recover later. And then in the worst case scenario, the agency might ask you to correct the record, which, like I said, could happen many years after the patent has been filed. So this is what we think that the agencies should send a message, which is to take title of the patents and not only simply allow the contractors to correct the record with a certificate of corrections. I'll stop here and I look forward to your comments and to the other presentations.